Okay, so chapter 17. This is a pretty big chapter, I think. I think I remember this was the first chapter I read when I first saw this book online. Because it really stood out to me. And so, yeah, I think this is, I guess when I think of advanced art, this is kind of like where the meat of the material is. So it's kind of awesome to present about it. So metaprogramming, that's the big idea here. And so I think we saw a pretty interesting example of that online in the internet this week, where we had this whole cake meme thing where you got this, the person that makes a cake designs it so the user sees it one way, but the underlying structure is different. And that kind of, it's like a good analogy for metaprogramming. And I thought it was a good excuse to throw in a meme. So, and you see this, what the cakes look like, and the internet went crazy, started creating these meta memes about it, where it's like, where's the cake? Now we're looking at the entire book. It's a different perspective, one layer up. And then there's one layer above that, where you cut that meme in half, and then another layer above that. It's recursive in a way. So that gets to the core of metaprogramming and how, we go and parse the whole abstract syntax. So the next thing, so exactly what is metaprogramming? It's like writing code to manipulate other code. I think Hadley gets to describe it in various ways in the chapter, but I think that's our idea there. And I think I wanted to address this early with the non-standard evaluation. I think these two ideas get conflated a lot, and it's important to distinguish them. So like non-standard evaluation is more a property, like if we're talking about programming and language as a grammar, it's more of like an adjective describing the arguments to a function or just how a certain variables are evaluated, whereas metaprogramming is like just a larger idea. So that's what this kind of this quote kind of describes. So big ideas, and I'm kind of going off script a little bit from the book, and kind of going more of what Hadley's talked about in some of the videos and presentations he's done. So I've distilled it down to like four big ideas. So this is perfect galaxy meme here. So we got first, R code is a tree. Second idea is you can capture trees or capture code by quoting. And the third idea is you can build out trees or evaluate your code by uncoding. And then the fourth big idea, combining some of these ideas, is capturing the trees and the environment. So when things get a little bit more complex, whenever you're dealing with functions and data frames, the idea is data masking and environment binding, those things can, it can become ambiguous at where your variable is being evaluated. That's where that idea kind of comes into play. So R code is a tree. So if we look at this literally, it doesn't really make sense. You open up the advanced R book and you see, R code is a tree. What did I learn? That doesn't make any sense. But, there's obviously a lot more to what that is. So R code is a tree. So R code is, and in fact, really any programming language is a tree. It can be described by expressions, I guess is the word we use in the book, which can be drawn as trees. So I think that's a better explanation. So our code is, a set of expressions that can be drawn as trees or parsed as trees. So this is a good quote I found on a blog that I think explains it in a, a good way. And we have the lobster package that we can use to break down any kind of code, R code, into an AST or a symbolic tree. It would be really nice if we get the color. I think if you do this at the console, you get the color. In the next chapter, as he talks about, it's not colored in the book or any of the code examples for technical reasons. So, I've been chiding Hadley a lot with some of his expressions. I think he's trolling us a little bit with here for complicated technical reasons. It's a very hand-waving expression. But yeah, so R code is a tree. So everything's a tree, you got your typical, variable assignment, your X being assigned a value 1. And you can see here, how that evaluates as a tree. You have control flow statements. Those are itself. So if and else are part of the symbolic tree. and also functions themselves. So even, you know, starts with the function name, and you get the arguments here right under the function name, and then the, you know, I guess the symbol names within the function come afterwards. Then you can even parse symbolic trees with AST as well. I thought that's kind of fun. So the second big idea, capturing trees by coding. So this is where he introduces the Erlang it stands for expression, that function. That's where you just provide it any code and it gives you back exactly that code. And you can evaluate it with the base R eval function. I think the base equivalent to expression is quote, but I think it's probably safer to use expression for reasons that we might cover in future chapters. But you can see how when we assign those values, you evaluate it afterwards. So you give it an expression to begin with where you haven't assigned X or Y any values, and it returns exactly that. And you're kind of playing around with code here because you haven't given it any value. So maybe another language might say, oh, that's an error. But since you haven't evaluated yet until you do it later after you assign the values to it, it's able to process that. So you're manipulating code with code. So, and then we bring up the idea of the ElHabr, which we typically use in expressions or functions. So I think the way he describes it is expression is a quote through expression, and you can see this here where it returns Z, the function, the name, the arbitrary name we've assigned the arguments in the function, instead of A plus B, which you might naively expect it to return A plus B. So if you did want it to return A plus B, you would use that ElHabr function. So that's, the important difference there. So N stands for enrich. That helps me, in my mental model, understand this better. It's enriching your expression that you pass in. And so now, it's no longer confusing the difference between those two. Essentially, I think using the N, the Erlang functions that are prefixed with N, use them in functions. They're just more safe. I think you could get away with using ElHabr in functions, like we showed here, but you're gonna get behavior that's probably different than what you would expect. So this is taken from, one of his videos, where he's kind of showing you, highlighting that what's the difference between something that's evaluated by normal R rules versus something that's being evaluated by special rules, where special rules are kind of a reference to coding and evaluating at a later time. So I guess when you use the library function, you're passing in ggplot2, but if you think about it, the environment doesn't know about that you have the ggplot2 package installed. You're passing in a variable name that doesn't have any value, but the way R works, it's able to see that bare variable name and know to go look it up in your installed packages and load that into your environment. And, a lot of the tidyverse stuff, like ggplot and deplyr kind of work or enable all that kind of behavior, passing in bare variable names to make it easier for the user. And I think, we've got examples down here. I guess you can call a normal assignment here, Z, being assigned x plus 1, you can call z as an expression that's evaluated according to special rules. Because if you think about it, anything on the left hand side, you haven't really, since you haven't actually assigned it anything yet, it's kind of out there as just some arbitrary symbol that doesn't have a value. I think that's why that's highlighted here. And that makes sense with and data frame z, it's an arbitrary name. I guess you could technically quote the Z and you would consider it evaluated according to normal R rules. But here, since it's a bare variable name, that's really a column name in a data frame, I guess it's really being evaluated according to special rules. So, the third idea, so uncoding. So we have our captured code. So what can we do with it? We saw a little bit of what you could do with it. But here, this is where the bang bang operator comes into play. We're able to break down what we had passed into and called this X1 variable. So it's not in the parse tree, it's not showing X1, it's showing the variables that you passed into it before. But now you're seeing, you know, what their names are, not X1. So it's, I guess it's like peeling back the layer or something. Like if you put a layer on top and then peel it back later, the layer on top is like, you're telling it, or you're putting something in a box and you're saying, I don't want to evaluate it yet, but I'm going to evaluate it later. So when you want to evaluate it later, you take off the top of the box and you see what's in the box. And so I think the point of this is to show it respects like order precedence and parentheses. So when we do the bang bang here on the expression one, it recognizes to make sure that x plus y in the denominator has the parentheses around it. So it's not x over x and then plus y. So it respects the normal rules of operations. And yeah, we can evaluate this expression too again. So we're seeing, even though we assigned the x and y variables to expression one way earlier, we see it unwrapped in this parse tree with the bing bang operator. So I think the funny thing about this is I've seen this online before where it's like, okay, what are the order of operations here? And people are like debate, I guess mainly with this one, is it 16 or one? So you got a bunch of people with hot takes on this. I think this random one with 100, but if you can pass this into R and you know, you'll get the answer to one. So it's like, you can break down any, I guess, PEMDAS, you can figure out what's the actual proper order of operations according to, I guess, your programming language. It might be different in other programming languages. Like I know the exclamation point in R, the operator for like not, has like a lower order of precedence. So like that might have a higher order of precedence in a different language. But I don't know, it's kind of cool that you can figure out, you know, arbitrary questions like this with your code, breaking it down into a tree and showing what's the correct answer. So the fourth big idea, capturing trees in environments. So we haven't really been, I mean, I've mentioned environments a little bit here, but we'll go into a little bit more detail. But this is where we bring up the term closure, which is, I think it helps to think about it as closure and quote, the closure being like a function that also recognizes the variables in the scope above it. I think at least one frame above it. And then quote, which is what we've been talking about with expressions, where it keeps exactly the variables that it passed into it, even if they don't have values. So yeah, they're important for disambiguating the context in which expressions are evaluated. So I think the big use cases here is it evaluated as a column in a data frame or as a variable in your environment? And we'll get to an example on that. So here's the example. So we've got this update function, and we've like arbitrarily assigned this value 1 to n. But we also have n assigned outside the function as 2. And we have our data frame here. So what we would get when you call this function update on, you know, your data frame and plus n? So it's different than what you might expect if you used just expression, but it's important to use n expression because it recognizes to use this n assigned to one here in the data frame. Oh, well, it's wrong. So yeah, you actually have to use n quote. So that's important, you're using closures here. It'll recognize that you want it to actually use the value of n here outside of the function. Which is what the user would probably expect. Or I think in most cases, the user would expect it to take on this value of 2 that they have assigned, not what you have arbitrarily assigned inside your function. Like say this is a function in some package, and you just so happen to use the same variable name as like what they pass in. So they wouldn't, it shouldn't matter to the user. They should just see that it, you know, n is equal to 2 here, and not interfered by with the n little one in the function. So that's the important closures. It's able to recognize that n is passed in from by the user from like the global environment, and ignoring the n that's assigned in the function. So I think this is funny because this is a contrived example, which we brought up a lot in this class or this book. But Hadley might call this a canonical example, where you take it to this base premise and show like exactly what the principle is here with closures. A contrived example, but you could call it a canonical example. So I think that's most of all I wanted to cover today. So just want to say the power of metaprogramming. We still have three chapters to go at least with this topic, but I think it's great. Metaprogramming is great, not only in R, but in every language. It powers things like linters and stylers, or the linter and styler package in R, but also linters in every language, because it has to be able to tokenize and figure out what is code, what is comments, and all that. So I think R is great because I think it probably provides more power than normal other languages for developers on how they can manipulate code with code. So I think I've seen before R is great for creating DSLs or domain specific languages, where it's like a language within a language. So R really has all the tools built out to do that kind of stuff. So I think it's great. Whenever you're like manipulating code with code, you really feel like powerful and all that. But I thought of this, if you don't know Cassidy Williams, she's a great person to follow on Twitter, but she has this whole thing, it's like, what she tells her friends when people ask her what she does in tech. It's like, oh, like she's doing all this magical stuff with code. That's kind of what I feel like when I'm doing some kind of metaprogramming thing, with whether it's using expressions or any kind of metaprogramming aspect. So there's more to cover. I didn't want to cover everything. I think I actually went a little bit into chapter 18 with R code as a tree, but I'm gonna hold myself not responsible for answering questions, because we're gonna defer that to future question or future chapters. So if I've confused anyone, hopefully there's clarity in the chapters that follow. So that's it. Oh yeah, I did have one thing. This chapter about trees really reminded me of this software class I took in college, where it was actually my intro to software class. I think it was actually the second software class I had done. But the final project was basically we had to build out code trees. We had to write code with code. And I thought this was extremely unfair. Like, when looking back upon this, it was like, how do you expect intro level software class to be able to do that? I guess if you're going to software development, this is probably like where, if you're able to do this, you probably know, okay, I'm going to be really good at this. So I'll tell you what, I struggled at it on it, and it was kind of one of those points I was like, I'm not sure if I want to go to like pure software development. I think looking back at it today, I feel like I'd be much more comfortable doing it, but I thought it was kind of funny. And you can see here, I think that on this final project, I got like a 50 or like half the score or whatever, because I wasn't able to pass all these unit tests. So I really I took the L with that one. But I was like, you know what? I think I was good enough with the rest of the semester. I got an A, and I was like, I'm just gonna ignore that. I didn't end up going into software development. So I was like, you know what? I did my best. But if I had known about trees and thinking of code as code as a tree, right? That whole idea, I would have been able to write better code to do that project. It was kind of something that I thought of when I was reading this chapter, and I thought it would be fun to share.